Thank you. Mary's in the house.
check. Are you turning me on, Zach? I am? It doesn't sound like it. Can you hear me, Zach? Oh, you can't.
I'll do it again. Maybe it automatically went off.
All right. Can you guys hear me? Check, 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 check.
Nope.
No checking. Welcome to Tech Talks. Check, check.
Let's see if I can see.
Checking on one. Check, check. Checking. One, two. Check, check. One, two. Check, check.
Okay.
Welcome to Tech Talks. I'm going to go ahead and keep talking up here as we check the mic. And Zach has no control over the volume right now. Yeah, I'm going to keep going. One, two. Shaking his head no. Benjamin's shaking his head no too. I'm good up there, but Zach can't control it. No control. What's that? Benjamin, are you trying to check something? And okay. I imagine they're all like that. You need me to do anything, Benjamin? Okay.
Oh, is it? This is on already. Yeah. Are you controlling them up there, Benjamin, to turn them on and off? These? Oh, okay. Good morning. On behalf of the Center for Professional Excellence, it's our pleasure to welcome you here to our second annual Tech Talks. I'm John Fernell.
And I'm Rachel Cobb. In our role here at the college, we have the unique opportunity to serve our faculty and staff as consultants, coaches, and mentors. Through those relationships, we've discovered a wealth of ideas and stories we're sharing. We're proud to provide a platform today for you to experience those innovative ideas and inspirational stories firsthand.
That was good.
We're pleased to feature five members of our GTC community. Out of respect for our speakers, we're asking that you please silence your devices and make sure there's no flash photography.
And with that, we invite you to sit back, relax, and enjoy Tech Talks, our thoughts, our stories, our people.
Okay, see, we're getting a little ringing. They're all on. Do we need to do that again just so you can check levels? Okay.
Benjamin. So are you trying to figure out how to route it so we can mute them down here? Or were you just adjusting the volume? How can we make it so Zach can? So you're saying somebody needs to be up in the booth?
Okay.
Is someone going to be up there?
And then whoever's in the booth will be able to mute the mics and adjust the levels. But there's no way to transfer all of...
So Zach needs to be up there tomorrow?
Benjamin,
yes, sir.
How come Zach was able to last week in the rehearsal. How come he was able to mute the mics back here and now he can't? So it has to do with the recording.
Right. If it's not the recording, you have full, if you don't need your recordings first, baby, we have full functionality on the
video. Okay, did you hear that, Zach?
No, didn't hear it.
Come on out here. I think you need to correct. He's saying that it all has to do with the streaming and recording. We have to do
that. Do we have to stream it to record it?
Yeah, we can record it without streaming it. That's fine. That's just how we did it last year.
Can we record it without streaming?
Not from the booth. That's how we are recording.
Okay.
Through an SMB encoder.
Okay.
If we don't need to record, we have full control on the Lector test stand. If we do need to record, we have to use the Mixer.
We need to record.
Okay. Otherwise, we get no recording?
Otherwise, we have no recording.
Oh, no.
Yeah, we need to record. It's fine. If Zach can handle all the sound, I can handle the screen.
It's just moving the slides, is what you're saying?
Yes. Yeah.
When did it start?
Everybody's here? It's 10. All right.
No, she's here.
Oh, okay.
Speakers, y'all sit tight for just a moment. We're adjusting technical things. Hey, this mic is hot. Whew. Gotta hold it down here. We kind of have this staticky sound that we're hearing up here. Like, shh, what is that? Is it just that the volume's up really high, or?
Is the handheld, is the other handheld on? Can we turn that one off?
Do we need to turn it on? Oh, there we go. Whatever you just did, that was.
Okay, while they're doing that.
Thank you. That was really loud down here.
Our speakers, we're going to have you in the front row down here.
Come to your seats.
I probably would recommend perhaps sitting in the order in which you'll be speaking. Okay. So we'd put Tracy here, Angelo, Monty, Harry, Amber.
Look at this crew.
The other way around, because you are going to be getting up and coming.
Amanda.
But that's okay. I said I've been Amy, Amanda. I had
you both had him.
Hi,
John.
Hi. At least you don't get called John Funeral, like I've been called. Funeral.
I'm not wearing this tomorrow.
That's okay.
Yeah.
And Zach's been called Zach Dishwasher.
A waste.
Okay. Probably.
I don't know.
Think back or on
the Angelo, sir, we're sitting in the order we're speaking, so you're in the number two seat.
Let's try that.
It's very tight.
I'm holding my fluff.
Everybody's fun. This is going to be great.
All right. So what we're going to do, we're working out some mic issues. So right now, in order for us to record it, it will only record using the two handhelds and one lapel. So for today's rehearsal, we are going to practice passing one lapel from speaker to speaker. This afternoon, they're going to see if they can't route it so that the two lapels are
and one
connected
handheld
to the recording. So it might be a little weird today. We're going to see how we can do that with the least amount of
dead space in between speakers.
But all that to say, that should not like fluster you. We will take the time that we need, and the audience can wait. If they're able to do that, then tomorrow morning, before we open the doors, we will do a very fast mic swap practice so that you get the feel for that. So typically what that would be, Tracy and Angelo would both be mic'd up, so they'd be good to go. And when Tracy finishes, Angelo would be coming up and Monty would be coming around to receive Tracy's mic from me. Mm-hmm. And then as Angelo finishes, Monty is walking on stage and Harry's coming over to receive Angelo's mic. And then as Monty finishes, Amber comes over to receive Monty's mic. Harry gets Angelo's, Amber gets Monty's. Okay. But for today, everyone will be passing the same mic. All right, and we'll see how that goes. That way, you know, if we can get two lapels by tomorrow, that'll be great. That will be a lot easier on you all, but we'll have practiced it with one if that's all we have. So what we're planning to do is we're going to jump in and do a straight run through.
No starts, no stopping,
as if it is the event.
Just keep going.
Yes, exactly.
This is tomorrow.
Yeah.
Whatever happens, we will not step out on the stage. We will not come get mics.
It's not.
You just keep going,
no matter what.
So we can get a sense of a straight run through. Once we finish that run through, then we'll note some of the things. We'll tweak a couple things if we need to. If anybody needs to get back up there and try something, we have the time to do that.
Man, I said pretend it's tomorrow. She's like, well, then it is, then we're done, right?
Yeah.
I was telling them earlier that I was wishing this was already tomorrow.
I know.
Yes. It's amazing what we volunteered for. Like, we chose this.
So there'll be that bouncy music playing in the background as people are filling in. When the music stops, Rachel and I are going to come out and do our very, very brief introduction.
Are you going to do that today?
Yes.
So should I be there or here?
Tracy, at that point, should be in the wings, right?
Yes.
Yeah, you should be in here because you'll be mic'd and ready. We'll be here with you. We'll step out.
And the clicker is?
It's right there.
Okay.
Oh, by the way, good point. The clicker lives here. Don't walk off with it. Don't put it in your pocket. Okay? It goes right there so everybody knows this is where you pick up your slide. And make sure you know, and you forward, backward, that you're not looking at what you're pressing.
John?
Yes.
Or do we want to enter from here?
I think we ought to come from there, because Tracy can be on sort of near
so
the
we'll
steps.
So we'll push you back just a little
just
bit,
because
I've got to come from back here. We have to have Zach up there, so I've got to just transition the first slide.
All right. So do you want to practice with the music, or just no?
Yeah, let's practice. Okay,
the music fade naturally?
And Tanya, it does, but I will have to pause it and advance the slide because of the way the video is embedded in it.
Okay.
So Tanya will be our, and Zach's up in the booth, so he'll give us some feedback as well. He'll adjust levels as you're speaking today, so don't worry about that if he needs to. Tanya, will you just kind of be our audience?
Yes.
And, like, do some applause as if. All right. Is everybody ready?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, let me get this video backed up, and we'll try it out.
Maybe I'll stand on the stair and hold on. That'll get me out of the way.
Don't worry, we're not playing the whole video.
Yeah, just play the last few seconds of the music.
In paper.
Right. All right, it just ended. Yay.
Good morning. On behalf of the Center for Professional Excellence, it is our pleasure to welcome you to our second annual Tech Talks. I'm John Furneaux.
And I'm Rachel Cobb. In our roles here at the college, we have the unique opportunity to serve as consultants, coaches, and mentors to our faculty and staff. Through these relationships, we have discovered a wealth of ideas and stories we're sharing. We're proud to provide a platform for you to experience firsthand these innovative thoughts and inspirational stories.
Today we're featuring five members of our GTC community, and we ask that out of respect for our speakers today that you silence your devices and that there be no flash photography.
And with that, we invite you to sit back, relax, and enjoy Tech Talks, our thoughts, our stories, our people. And the clicker is not working.
Is it on? Nope, it went.
I think she got it. All right, it's all yours.
Okay. It was not very often that I was able to spend the night at my grandparents' home. You see, they lived in a small, secondhand Airstream trailer on a campground. And as a kid, I thought it would be a grand adventure to spend the night. But the truth is, the camper was so small that the only place they had for a sleepover guest was to lower their kitchen table and make a twin bed. When I was about 10, my grandparents invited my sister and I to spend the night with them for a couple of days. We were very excited until we got there. We quickly realized that it was very hot, we were bored, and I commented to my grandmother that there was nothing good to eat. My grandmother took me in to the camper, and in just a few moments, she opened the small refrigerator, took out a bag of apples that had a few remaining ones in the bottom of it, sat those on the counter, pulled some flour from the cabinet, some sugar, some cinnamon, and a few other ingredients. It was like magic being made. I'm gonna have to pause. Is there any way to dim that light or redirect it? I cannot see a thing.
It's showbiz, babe.
Hang on, it's making my head hurt. I'm trying to think of where I can turn. I'm sorry, John, I know I'm messing this up.
Try not to look directly at it. But there isn't a way to...
Okay, so it is what it is.
Yeah, if we dim it...
Then it's going to mess up the quality. Okay. All right, I think I can manage. Do you want me to just start over, pick up where I left off? Okay, so she had taken the ingredients out, sat them on the counter, and was... very quickly had peeled and cored the apples. She then made a dough, and she quickly wrapped the apples with the dough, put them on a cookie sheet, and placed them in a very small oven. Think easy bake. A few minutes later, the camper began to smell like apples and cinnamon. It was amazing. A few more moments later, she took these golden brown apple dumplings out of the oven. I remember two things from that afternoon. First, they were the most amazing apple dumplings I've ever had. And second, I was amazed at how my grandmother had made something out of nothing. What I thought was this wonderful adventure was not an adventure for my grandparents. They lived in this Airstream trailer, not because they were looking for a way to camp, but because they lived in poverty. My grandmother lived in poverty her entire life. This was her story. She was the second oldest of eight children living in a family in rural Appalachian, West Virginia. When her older brother Earl died suddenly, she had just finished the third grade, entering in the fourth. Her father did not value education, especially for girls, and felt that her use was better for her to stay home and help her mom raise her six younger siblings. That would become her life story, is taking care of others. She intermittently went to the fourth grade, but unfortunately, her education ended there. She entered her adulthood functionally illiterate, married young, and started a family of her own, which she raised in poverty. Her children grew up, none of them would finish high school, all of them would marry young, and all of them would enter into their adulthood, dealing with poverty on their own terms. My mother married when she was 17 and decided to start her family. At that point, she did not complete her education until many years later when she went and completed her GED, which she did after she had started a family of her own. My grandmother, when she passed away at 87, had buried an infant son, she had buried an adult son, she had buried a husband of 45 years, and she had grieved the loss of her independence through a catastrophic stroke that took the use of her dominant arm about 16 years before her death. Despite all the adversity, despite all the challenges she lived with, she was the most beautiful, loving, gracious, funny, faithful woman I ever knew. My mother used to tell me that my grandma made poor bearable, and that was really how she faced her life. She rose above her struggle, she rose above her adversity, and she took everybody that she loved along with them. I used to think of my grandmother being this tough old lady. Although she was very gentle spirit, she was still tough. She never wavered, she was so steady. And what I realized now as an adult was that my grandmother was far more than tough, she was resilient. Resilience has been studied for decades. It's understood to be experiencing an adversity, applying and finding meaning through that adversity, and applying that meaning to the situation you're currently faced to lower your own experience of distress and maybe feel a little stronger in those moments. It has been considered a cycle, a continuum, a process, a trait, and more recently understood to be a skill. It's a skill that can be learned, it can be polished, it can be developed with intentional practice. The other thing we know about resilience is that when you talk with people who see themselves as resilient and others that see them as resilient, that they have a single common denominator, and that is that they have lived with a champion in their life, a cheerleader, a go-to person, someone that's always in their corner. I have been loved by so many people and have been supported in many ways, have had lots of cheerleaders and lots of champions. But if I'm honest, my grandma was my favorite. Like my mother, I got married at 17. I left home. I graduated early from high school, and I changed our family trajectory by enrolling in community college and starting my college education. That changed our long history of functional illiteracy in creating an opportunity for education. Within the first semester of my enrollment in community college, I realized that I was pregnant. And at that time, it became very obvious that I was not going to be able to continue my college enrollment. With a broken heart and a lot of sadness and a whole lot of panic, I embraced the idea of being a young mom. I took a deep breath. I relied on my grandmother's example of doing hard things, even when you knew that they were going to be harder than you could imagine, and trust that with a family system and a loving support system that I would get through it. And I did. About a year later, I found myself alone as a single mom with an 8-week-old baby. I had no resources, I had unstable housing, I had no money, and I had no education. I knew that the way out of the situation that I was in, and that I was now taking my 8-week-old daughter in, was to go back and get an education. I went to the same community college that I left over a year before, sat down with an academic counselor, and explained to her my situation. I told her I didn't have 4 years to get my life together. I had about 2 years, and that was about it. She smiled knowingly, and she suggested nursing. I believe I laughed and explained to her that that was a really bad idea. I was well known in my doctor's office for passing out or throwing up anytime they took my blood. Blood was not my thing. And so I, again, shared this with her, and she said, no, you know, I really think this is the best thing. I tried to talk her into some other things, and she was very clear that if I wanted a career, I wanted an income that was going to help me take care of my daughter, that this was an effective way to do it. I wish I could say I was in love with the idea of nursing, but I wasn't. I was in love with the idea of taking care of this 8-week-old baby. So I signed all of the application paperwork. I did the admission paperwork. I filled out my FAFSA, because we all know you have to do that every year. Submitted all the paperwork and picked up my 8-week-old daughter, carried her to my car, a 1982 Ford Escort that burned more oil than it did gas. I put her in her car seat, I sat in front of the steering wheel, and I cried. And then I cried some more. And then I did what good daughters do, I went and found my mother. And I thought surely my mother was going to come up with a better second plan or talk some sense into my head. She did not. She said, you can do this. You're smart, you're capable, you know how to do hard things. We do hard things. You can do this. So I took another deep breath and then began to problem solve what other things I needed to address before I could start nursing school. My biggest gap was housing and income. I did something that no one in my family had ever done before. I went to social services and applied for welfare. I grew up in a family that lived paycheck to paycheck. I always knew where the next meal was coming from, despite how questionable that meal may be. My mother was well known for stretching a dollar, and at the end of a paycheck, that meant questionable casseroles or really questionable pots of soup that you saw for 3 and 4 days at a time that came from leftovers in the refrigerator. But it was still where the next meal was coming from. At that point, I could not provide that for my daughter. So I went through the process of applying for welfare and had a very emotional response to that, a lot of shame, a lot of regret, a lot of remorse, but I didn't have a lot of time to dwell on that. A few short weeks later, I started nursing school and went to orientation, and at that point, they explained to me that I needed to come in a uniform with all the proper equipment, and I panicked, and I thought, I don't know why this did not occur to me. I can't wear street clothes. I went back to the academic advisor, explained my situation, and she handed me a scholarship paper. And she explained that the scholarship was only for $500, but maybe it would help. A month later, I found out that I had been awarded the scholarship. I had just enough money in that $500 to buy 2 uniforms, a pair of nursing shoes, a stethoscope, a pen light, and I had just enough for a pair of bandage scissors. It was just enough. If I'm honest, I was highly unprepared for nursing school. I was unprepared for the volume of information, the amount of technical skills I was going to have to learn, the amount of things that I did not know and I was not good at. Nursing school humbled me and it strengthened me. I learned how to practice intentionally and be thoughtful about the things I needed to do to be successful. And then I learned that there were things that I was never going to be good at, but I needed to be safe at. So with practice and time, I continued to work. The other thing I was not prepared for is the long commute. I spent more time in the car driving from one rural campus to another rural campus, and then from the second year from my campus to an inner city that I had never even visited just to be able to graduate. I got through all of that not because of my smarts or my capability, but because of my persistence and because of the resilience that my grandmother role modeled for me. And again, doing something hard, even when you couldn't see more than a few feet in front of you, you just kept walking. I had the perfect motivation of being a young single mom and knowing that the things I was doing in that day were going to change our life. I graduated 2.5 years later. When I walked across the stage and I looked out into the lawn, I saw my daughter who was 2.5. She was swirling in her pink dress, oblivious to the life changes that were going on in front of her. I also saw my family, especially my mom. What I saw in my mom's face was pride and probably a little bit of relief. She and I knew in that moment that my life was changing, and changing in a way that we would not fully appreciate until many years later. I now have 4 college degrees, all of them in nursing. One of my last doctoral degrees is from a premier, nationally renowned nursing institution, but I am proudest of my associate degree in nursing. That was the degree that changed my life. I once heard a comedian talk about the difference between a university graduate and a community college graduate. He commented that if you ask someone that went to a university, they would tell you, I went to Furman, I went to Upstate, I went to Clemson. You ask someone who went to a community college, they tell you a story. And it often starts with, I took some classes, and then I took some time off. Maybe I had a baby, I got married, my car broke down, I needed a new job, and then I took some more courses. And for some people, that's a loop where they just continue for a while. And some people, they complete their degree and they graduate. Those are my people. Those are the people that stick with something, that work hard, that despite all the barriers and all the challenges, they get to the other side and they reach a goal. My grandmother did not live long enough to see me wear my doctoral regalia. I have 2 deep prayers. First, that the world will see my grandmother in me. And second, that my grandmother's proud of me, as proud of me in being her granddaughter as I am to be her granddaughter. Thank you.
Don't worry about that. He'll turn it on. Are you going to put that down on the floor?
Over the years, I've realized that there are 3 types of missions. There's the missions that you can accept, the missions that you can decline, and the missions that's just thrown in your lap. But one thing all those missions have in common is that they're all time sensitive. And this time is not going to stop for anyone. You could call a timeout in football, but real time always continues to move forward. And one thing that I've realized is that everything that we do requires time. And if you understand the significance of time, then you can learn the importance of being intentional about how you utilize your time. One thing that I've learned over the years was that every mission that I have ever accepted or that was thrown in my lap was always possible. And the reason they were possible was because, you see, this woman right here, my mother, she's what they call a dissectologist. A dissectologist is a person that has a passion to put together puzzles, jigsaw puzzles. So if you notice, my mother's looking at the box, so she always would look at the big picture, but she would
dump out that 1,000-piece puzzle on the table, and she would learn how to figure it out. So the mission in life for me, she said, your mission, if you should accept, is to put the pieces of the puzzle of your life together so that you can live up to your fullest potential. So I said, Mama, you know what? I believe I can do that. So my mother began to, she was my rock. She was the one that taught me pretty much everything that I know. She had the winning combination herself. She had a strong work ethic, and she knew God. What a combination. She knew the winning combination. She was the hardest working person that I ever met in my life. I watched her when I was growing up in New York. I watched her do domestic work. I had no idea what that meant for the longest, but she went into white people's homes and she cleaned their homes. And because it was summertime, she would set me on a bench and she would tell me, Angelo, don't you touch a thing. And she would turn on the Mets, New York Mets baseball game. And I would watch the Mets while she did domestic work. I watched her get on her hands and knees. And she would watch people's houses. They look clean already to me. But she would get down and she would clean them up. But she said, Angelo, there's some things that I want you to understand. Whatever you do in life, you make sure that you dress the part. You dress for success. So if you see the young man sitting down front and center in the middle on this floor in the blue double-breasted suit with a suede collar, that would be me. My mother gave that part to me. That was a mission that I received. And even to this day, I get compliments on the way I dress. It didn't start just yesterday. It started when I was in the fifth grade. Fifth grade. You can look at everybody else around me. Who looks the best? I'm not making this stuff. I can't make this story up. My mother told me that I was going to be successful. She said, if you want to accomplish anything in life, you need to learn how to listen. You need to learn how to take orders. You need to learn how to do all the things that you need to do to create the best version of yourself at all times. You don't necessarily have to talk all the time, Angelo, but you need to make sure that you go and do what you need to do. And I believed her. But even though I looked sharp on the outside here, I messed around and brought an F home one day. And my mother was a tickler for Fs because she never believed in that grade never existed. So when she would talk to me about, Angelo, I need you to go to school, I had never missed a day in school in my life. But this one particular time, for some reason, I got an F because I did not understand the mission. I felt the mission miserably, and it was the longest walk home that I ever had in my life because I knew what was going to happen when that lady that put that puzzle together, when that dissectologist gets a hold of me, she's going to dissect me. So when I got home, my mother, I knew it was coming. When she got to the house, she said, Angelo, how in the world can you go to school every single day and make an F? How can you? Her voice got higher. I knew what was coming. She said, how in the world can you go to school every single day? The time has run out. The results are in. And you brought home an F. You could have kept your black blankety blank 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 home and made an F. Come here. That was the end of that story. But I learned the lesson. When I saw my mother putting those puzzles together, one thing I began to realize is that sometimes life throws some missions in your lap that you don't understand. Sometimes it's like having a 1,000-piece puzzle but never seeing the box, never seeing having a reference. See, I never had a father, so I didn't know the reference of being a man. I never had that in my life. I had some people, had uncles, but I never had a man that lived in the house. I had two older brothers and an older sister, but I never had a man living in the house. So I had no reference. So I had to figure some things out about this puzzle of life. I realized that my potential would allow me to accomplish any missions that I would ever face in my life. And one thing that I learned that my mother taught me was that you always can start with the outside of the puzzle because the edges are square. They're flat, so you can always work with the outside. But the thing about the puzzle is the most important part of the puzzle is what's inside of you. I didn't know who I was, so I had to work on my identity. Who in the world is Angelo Kendrick? So I began to work, but it wasn't until I joined the United States Army that I began to learn how to put some of these pieces of the puzzle together. See, what happened to me when I joined the Army, a few years in, that I was selected for recruiting duty. I often tell people that, you know, it's important that you find your niche, find that gift, find that thing that you would just love to do. If you didn't make a penny, find that thing that you just love to do. And when I was selected for recruiting duty, I said, oh my God, this is it. I was talking to people. I was meeting people. I was helping people figure out what they could do with their life. Because I had started putting some of the pieces of the puzzle myself together. I learned some things about confidence when I went in the Army in basic training, and I learned some things about confidence, going through a confidence course, way up here, walking on a beam. And they said, you could do it. Private Kendrick, walk across. No problem. Whatever you say, I got it. So I walked across. So I learned some things. There's some things that when you get the confidence to do it, and you mess around and find the pieces of the puzzle that you need to be able to accomplish the mission, everything flows seamlessly. So as I began to figure out some more of the pieces of the puzzle, I realized that I loved recruiting. I love recruiting so much that I did it for 17 of my 22 years in the United States Army. When I left the military, I had no college whatsoever. But I decided that because I had the transferable skill to recruit, it was easy for me to recruit for BMW and General Electric and A.I. Hewitt, big companies. No college degree, but I had the skills. I had the know-how. I had everything that I needed to be able to fill the shoes of a successful businessman. Get out there and make it happen. So I began to put the puzzle together. But one place as a recruiter that I would frequently go to, I was recruiting in South Carolina, and I would go to Greenville Technical College, and I would recruit. And the first person I met when I stepped foot on Greenville Tech was a tall gentleman, and his name was, it'll come to me. But when I met this gentleman, it changed my, I knew that Greenville Tech was a great place to work, but I didn't have a college degree. I had worked for Virginia College. I had worked for Advanced Technology Institute. I had worked for IT Technical Institute, but I didn't have a college degree. When it came time for me wanting to work at Greenville Tech because of the things that I experienced as a recruiter walking on that campus, the atmosphere, the culture of the school, I fell in love with it. So in order to come to Greenville Tech, I had to go back to school. So I went to school. So some of the pieces of the puzzle was, one, I had to go back. I had to commit to going to school to get a degree so that I could get the job that I really wanted. I applied for the recruiting position at Greenville Tech 2 times with no degree. I finally got my bachelor's degree, applied 1 more time, and presto, it was like magic. I got the job working at Greenville Technical College. I became a recruiter for Greenville Technical College, going out into all the community. I was already familiar with all the schools because I was a recruiter in Greenville Tech, in Greenville County. So I knew what I needed to do to accomplish whatever I needed to accomplish. So I established the relationships, I came on board, and I was able to be successful. So I began to continue to put the pieces of the puzzle together because by now I knew what I enjoyed doing, standing in front of students to help them. But one day I was sitting down with Dr. Alicia Watt, and she asked me some questions. And I said, you know, she asked me, do you plan on staying in education, Angelo? I said, yes. She said, you know what? You have the skills. You have the knowledge. You have the experience. why don't you go back to school? And then we start talking about doctoral. And I said, whoa, you need to pump your brakes there, Dr. Y. So I told her that, but by the time I left her office, I was so pumped up that I decided to go back to school to get my master's at Liberty University in executive leadership, because it opened the doors for me to not only to be a recruiter at Greenville Tech, but to be a adjunct professor. Who would have ever thought that young kid sitting in the floor in the fifth grade would rise to the level of being an adjunct professor teaching in school? So I was excited. So as I began to continue to put the pieces of the puzzle together, I began to fulfill that mission of finding a combination to unlock my potential so I could accomplish any missions that ever came my way. So I began to continue to march and continue to march. So when it came time for me to be able to accomplish the mission, it was easy. All I had to do was stay the course. All I had to do was understand the importance of time, the significance of time, making sure that I did everything that I needed to do to land on my feet, not only land on my feet, but to be able to reach back and help other people. So there came a time that I had the opportunity to choose a position as the project coordinator for the African American Male Scholars Initiative at Greenville Technical College. They threw a number at me and said, look, we're right at 130 of scholars, and we need to be at 200 by such and such a time. No problem, because what I do is I recruit. What I do is I go out there and I tell the story. I make sure that individuals understand the importance of their time. They said 200, how about 263? So now we're sitting at 263. Why? Because I understand the mission. I understand that I have all the potential that I need to make things happen. So in my asking, I ask that if you should choose the mission, your mission is, if you choose, to reach deep down in yourself, find your full potential. Don't be afraid of failure. Failure is just a prerequisite for success. Don't be afraid. Get out there and do. But it's not about you. It's about what you can do to help other people walk across the stage of life, to help them find the tools that they need to be successful. They're in them. Every one of us is like my mother. We are all dissectologists. We all are trying to figure out our own puzzle to put it together. So with that, I thank this woman here for everything that she has ever done for me, my greatest supporter, introducing me to God, making sure that I understood that I read a book that said that I was fearfully and wonderfully made, that there's nothing that I cannot do, said that I am more than a conqueror. I can do everything. There's nothing impossible. So failure is not an option for me. When I try to use the word failure, my inner Grammarly says no. It will not accept it. It says failure and quit are not words that we can send in any message that you partake in. So I encourage you, will you accept the mission? All it takes is focus. You don't have to see the big picture, but you need to know that the means to the end is within you, and there's nothing that you cannot do. The mission is possible.
back to school, ring the bell, brand new shoes, walking blues, climb the fence, books and pens. I can tell that we are gonna be friends.
Hi, friends. That's a great song, huh? Jack White and the White Stripes, if you're interested. Does anyone have any songs about friendship they'd like to share? Do you know a song about friends? Do you? At this point, Cindy is going to say, yes. Toy Story. Gotta have friends. Yeah. Friends have value. How much are your friends worth to you? Are they worth mere pennies, or are they priceless to you? On a scale of 1 to 5, how would you measure up as a friend? How many dollar signs would you give yourself as a friend? Are you a good friend? 5? She's great. How about you? 3? Okay, we're going to help you. You're a 1? Oh, you need to come up on stage. Actually, I'll see you after the show. How about that? Isn't it true to have a friend, well, to be a friend, is to be a friend? Sorry, guys. Trying to get off book here. Be a friend. Friends, I'm so sorry, guys. Just having a moment. What are your friends worth to you? Y'all, I'm sorry, I'm blanking.
Take a deep breath, think about it.
Yes, isn't it true? To have a friend is to be a friend. And friends, yes, they enrich our lives in innumerable ways. Okay, I'm back on track. Friends also have value in other ways. Studies show that people who have friends, healthy relationships, have a lower risk of health issues, significant health issues, like high blood pressure and depression. In fact, older adults who have meaningful friendships live longer than their peers who have fewer connections. Last week, there was a study that came out that spoke of the same thing. So we know our friends really do have value in other ways. I'd like to share a story about why I'm here today. I had seen the announcements from the Center for Professional Excellence about this year's Tech Talks, and I saw last year's, and I loved it. And I thought, gosh, I feel so led to do this. But I put it on the back burner because I had no idea what I would speak about. A couple of weeks later, I ran into an old friend of mine. And by old friend, I mean she's barely 35, so my young old friend. We were friends about 15 years ago. We lost touch, but we volunteered together at a children's charity. So we vowed that we would stay in touch this time. I gave her my card. She called me. I called her back. Then we started texting. We figured out a place to go, and we went downtown Greenville, where we met up again, and we had coffee, and we went shopping. Well, we caught up on everything, and shared disappointments about life, and okay, we ended up talking about guys, but like we always did. She looks at me from across the table. She's got tears in her eyes. And she says, oh my God, I'm so glad that we're here. I can't believe you called me back. And we're here together having coffee. I've been so lonely. Well, I got choked up too. We were hugging, and that's when I had the epiphany. This is what I would talk about, friendships. So I auditioned, and of course, here we are. As a fundraiser for the Greenville Tech Foundation, my relationships with our donors are as important as the contributions they make to our college and to our students. When I was hired nearly 2 years ago, it was noted by the hiring committee that although I did not have direct fundraising experience, I'd been building relationships with my radio listeners for the last 30 years. I was a morning radio personality. And although that was part of the job, it was just what I did naturally. I love my friends. I have many friends, many circles of friends, many different kinds of friends. But at the heart of it all, the famous quote by Emily Dickinson, "My friends are my estate," captures what I believe is the true essence of friendship. When you realize how important your friends are, you know, there's a perspective, a shift, change, when you can look and say, yes, my friends are worth more than anything. These coins of friendship go way beyond the material and contribute to the overall wealth, really, of our well-being. So back to what I do as a fundraiser. I realize that I do this all the time in my role as a fundraiser. I do this all the time in making friends. So I thought I would share with you the three of the basic principles of fundraising and how you can apply that to making friends. I really think it'll work. The first principle is identifying or prospecting. Number two, cultivating. And three is stewardship. In identifying and prospecting in sales and, you know, that in that world, sorry, I need water. I can't even talk right now. I'm so sorry. I didn't plan well, John. And I've got water in my purse. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry, y'all. I don't mean to botch everything, but I really can't even talk. Identifying and prospecting. Yes, in sales, that is, never mind. He's gonna go get water. In sales, this is prospecting for what would be your potential client or customer. In our case, potential donor or potential friend. So sorry. So I was given a donor as a prospect. I'm not going to share names or anything today. And she had given a significant gift last year. And so I was so excited to get to know her better. I decided I would call her and ask her to a culinary luncheon at the Culinary Institute of the Carolinas. Well, I left a message, and then I followed up with an email, as I often do. Well, she wrote me back, and she said, well, I figured you were going to ask for money, so I didn't answer the phone. Well, you know, we get that all the time. So then she writes, but I would love to go to the culinary luncheon with you. Well, we went. It was wonderful. So we already planned our next outing. So we went to lunch again, and we're sitting there and having a wonderful time. I really like her. And she says, my name again, Monty Whitson. Whitson, do you know a Pat Whitson? I said, yeah, of course, that was my mom. She says, I used to work with her at Taylor's Elementary School. I'm totally freaking out. And we used to have lunch together in the cafeteria. Yeah, she was a teacher, and my mom was a teacher's aide. And of course, I got choked up because here we are at lunch, and I'm thinking my mom has, you know, set this whole thing up from heaven, right? So she turned out to be really, really valuable to me because when I'm with her, of course, I have memories of my mom. But she turned out to be a great prospect in many ways. So prospecting is really important. By the way, if you are an introvert, any introvert, is it hard to make friends? Well, you make great friends, don't you? Okay. Thank you so much. If it's hard for you to make friends, I ask for you to, maybe you should talk with your other friends about them introducing you to a group of friends and they can identify for you. One moment, sorry. Principle number two, cultivation. Cultivation is developing something or growing something, kind of like gardening. So this great couple, they donate to our African American Male Scholars Initiative, OMSI. And they were given to me too as donors, but we were already in the cultivation stage. So I thought of ways that we could all have fun together. Well, guess what? I found out that they love the theater. So we went to see a show. Actually, they came to see me in a show earlier this year in Simpsonville, at the Simpsonville Art Center. So I love that they love the theater. So of course, you better believe, I took them to the Pelzer Auditorium. They call that the Peace Center of Pelzer. I don't know, you really need to check it out. It's really a great venue. So cultivating is growing that friendship and doing things with them that make them happy, surprising them. That's how we develop and grow friendships. Third, stewardship. So you can't cultivate, you can't steward without cultivating first. Stewardship is the responsible management of something or taking care of something. Maybe money. You can be a steward of money. You probably heard that in church, especially. Well, I'd like to share a story of stewardship. And I had been in Myrtle Beach as a morning radio personality, and I lost my job. I had been in radio for 30 years, never lost my job until about 6 years ago. Well, there I was, devastated, really terrified, because I had no savings. I didn't have a roommate. I was not married. My parents were both deceased, and so I really did feel terribly alone. Well, I looked for a job for 2 weeks. I knew in 2 weeks I wouldn't have any more money, and I'd have to go back to Greenville as a failure, I felt. I know I wasn't a failure, but I felt like it. And my brother couldn't take me in. Well, I put it out on social media, my dilemma, and honey, before I could even pack the U-Haul that I'd rented, I had offers, several offers. Live with us. We'll take you in. You're not alone. What was probably the scariest moment of my life became the most beautiful thing that really ever happened to me, because I got to be stewarded this time after all those years of cultivating and growing friendships. I got to be stewarded. I got to experience the other side of the coin. I'd like to leave you with these final thoughts. What are your friends worth to you? What kind of investment have you made in your friends? If you'd like deeper relationships and more authentic connections, maybe it's time to take stock of your friendships. Take an assessment, an audit, if you will. Are you in the black, in the red? How much equity do you have in the bank of your friendships? Do you put in more withdrawals? I mean, do you deposit more? Or do you take out more withdrawals in the bank of your friendships? Check your balance, because I believe the real worth of our friendships are found in the faces of our most treasured friends. Thank you.
I was thinking about this topic when I was thinking about the subject. I'm fascinated with stories, because every story comes with a process. And a lot of times, it doesn't matter if the process was a successful process, if it was a failed process. a process is still a process, and I'm just fascinated with processes in life. And it made me think about this one story when I wanted to make some macaroni and cheese for my fiance. And I already knew how she feel about macaroni and cheese because when we go down to Charleston, my grandmother makes macaroni and cheese, and she loves my grandmother's mac and cheese. So I just decided to have a crazy thought one day, and I said, I'm gonna make some macaroni and cheese. I didn't want to make Kraft. I didn't want to make Velveeta. I wanted to make it bake style. Where's my bake style macaroni and cheese people at in here? So when I thought about what this was going to take, I said, wow, this is going to be a process that I've never done before. I wonder if there's anybody in here who's ever had a process in their life that they've never done before, that they never tried before, that they never completed before. So I instantly called my mother on the video call, and she walks me down each step. She sends me to the store. She tells me to get these ingredients. She tells me to get milk and get mac and cheese noodles and get the cheese and the different types. So I'm like, all right, great. This is going to work out perfect. So when I get to the point of putting the macaroni and cheese in the oven, and as we're sitting there going through all the different steps, and once the mac and cheese comes out, it was wonderful. So I was so excited, because my fiance, look on her face, it was beautiful. She was so excited and so happy. So here's where the story changes a little bit, because I decided to make the mac and cheese again. But throughout this process this time, I said, we're gonna eat a little healthier. So instead of using the milk, the evaporated canned milk that my mother told me to use, I decided to use fat-free milk. Little did I know, I had no idea that it was gonna throw everything off. So at that moment, I started to realize that I didn't trust the process. And I was thankful that my fiance spared my feelings and told me that she still enjoyed the mac and cheese, but I already knew that it wasn't the same as the first time. So when we talk about trust the process, I want you to join me today in just opening your mind, opening your hearts, and thinking about where this journey is gonna take you, because I suggest that there's a process that you need to trust today. So what is the process that you need to trust? For some of us, it may be an educational process. For some of us, it may be a financial process. For some of us, it may be a spiritual process. And for some of us, it may be a parental process, because we know children are not always the easiest to deal with in life. But even through the process, there's three things that you need, three things that you need. You need consistency, you need commitment, and you need confidence. And I want to walk you through what these three things look like in a process. So I wanted to start with consistency, because I suggest that a lot of times in life, we think consistency is an upward movement. We think that it's elevation, because the more that you do something, you should get better at it. You should show up always excited to do it. And I think about work sometimes, because when I come to work, I'm not always on 100%. There's just some days where I just got out the bed and I just threw my clothes on after taking a shower and say, you know, we're just gonna go in and do the best that we can. When I think about consistency, I think about just showing up and doing the best that you can. Matter of fact, scratch that. Let's talk about the gym, because I know we got some gym folks in here, and I know that when you think about consistency and going to the gym, it don't matter if you go for 10 minutes, it don't matter if you go for 30 minutes, it don't matter if you go for an hour. As long as you show up and give your best effort forward, then that's being consistent to your process. I was even thinking about how I was gonna show you guys this. So when I get to this next image, you're gonna see what I was thinking about. So I was thinking about myself, because I know that when it comes to trusting the process, I struggle with consistency sometimes. So when I thought about how to show you this, I thought about the cell phone. It does not matter if your cell phone is charged up, fully charged. It doesn't matter if your cell phone's on 50%. It don't matter if your cell phone's on 20%. Your cell phone's still gonna make that call. Your cell phone's still gonna make that text. Your cell phone is still gonna get on the internet. As long as your cell phone has some type of charge in it, then the consistency is going to continue to keep going. Let's talk about commitment. What does commitment mean to you? I have to slow down a little bit right here, because I was thinking about this, and commitment to some people looks like 7 days a week. But there's a group of people, commitment just looks like 2 to 3 days out the week. And I want to deal with the people that commitment looks like no days at all. I've been there. You see, when we think about commitment sometimes, I think we often get it confused with motivation. And Jim Rohn said it best. Motivation is what gets you started, but commitment is what keeps you going. I suggest there's three types of people in life. There's a defeated person, there's a motivated person, and there's a committed person. And see, the committed people, they know that they have to just keep going. They don't have time to stop. They have to keep going through the process. They may have a child. They may have a goal. They may have an ambitious dream. And they know that if they stop, then everything is ruined. So let me talk to the motivated people who just get started. You get hyped up, you get geeked up, you're like thinking about me right now on stage, and you're like, yes, Harry, we're gonna take all this stuff you're saying right now, and we're gonna go back out there and do nothing. And then we have our defeated people. They're the people who kinda slouch backs in the chair right now. They may have walked out when I got started, and that's okay, I don't take it personal. They may be scrolling on their phone right now, even though y'all asked them to put it on silent. But I suggest that the defeated person is the person that's just going through the motions of life. And I was thinking about the time when I was defeated in life. I was sitting in a room, it was dark, all the lights turned off, all the blinds closed, I wasn't eating. I had just gotten into a very bad car accident where we hit two parked cars sitting in an outlet's parking lot. And my mom came in the room and she told me that you cannot continue to sit here in the darkness. You need to get back to the light. You have to realize that you gotta keep going in life. This is just a preview of what life has to offer for you. You will get knocked down, but as long as you get back up, that's where you keep going and commit to getting back up each and every single day. Finally, I wanna talk about confidence. We talked about consistency and how you have to be consistent and show up on any percent that you're on. We talked about how you have to commit to the process and not just simply be motivated or not just be defeated in the process. But let's deal with this confidence. And I was thinking about how to show you this. And when I looked at this image, I was looking at the fact that, number one, she doesn't want to look into the mirror. I wonder if there's ever been a time in our life well, we didn't want to look in the mirror because we didn't want to see what was looking back at us. I suggest that there's times in our lives where we are self-sabotaging ourselves. When I was looking at the chaos from what's going on in the other picture in the mirror, I was thinking that sometimes in life we cause our chaos in our own life. And I was making sure that I was clear on trying to walk you through this process, because when you get to this point in life, it's time to redirect. It's time to reframe. It's time to regather. You're going to have to get around some support systems. You're going to have to get around some people who can lift you up. You're going to have to be correctable. You're going to have to be coachable. And you're going to have to keep moving forward to get to that confidence. And this is what confidence looks like. I laughed at this image because some of you may be saying, oh, he probably picked this image because he had the suit and tie on. But I suggest that I picked this image because I wonder who's in here today who's ready to get out of the defeated stage. I wonder who's ready in here today to get out of the motivated stage. I wonder who's ready to join me in the committed stage, in the consistency stage, in the confidence stage. Because when I look at this image right here, I think about me walking across the stage and getting a degree already in my hand. Matter of fact, scratch that. When I look at this image here, I think about me jiggling the keys to the new house, standing outside with the soul sign, with the realtor. Matter of fact, scratch that. When I think of this image right here, I look at me with the new car driving off the lot and the keys jiggling and the new car smell. I wonder where my new car smell people at. Yeah. Consistency, commitment, confidence. And when you think about all of these things, this is how you trust your process. I never said not one time the process would be easy. I never said not one time that you're not going to face trials in the process. I never even said one time that the process wasn't going to hurt. But I challenge you today, and I leave you with three things. Number one, don't lie to the process. Where are my people at who can't stand liars? And I was thinking about what my grandma would always say. It's easier to cover the truth than it is to cover a lie. Because once you tell one lie, you got to keep on telling them. So don't lie to the process. Number two, don't rush the process. I laughed at this one because I know we got some speeders in here. Is there anybody in here who get in the car and start driving a little bit too fast and some sirens get behind you because you gotta slow down? We gotta give you a speeding ticket. It's the same way with your process. Don't rush your process trying to speed to your destination because you'll get stopped. Finally, don't cheat the process. I thought about this slowly because I don't want you to get to the class before graduation and you plagiarize your paper. I don't want you to say I do at the altar and you go do infidelity. It's very important that you don't cheat the process. Don't lie to the process. Don't rush the process. Don't cheat the process. Trust the process.
I'd like to tell you a story about a student who found out at the age of 17 that he was going to be a father. Although not part of his plan, he married the mother of his child and started a family. He was able to finish high school, but quickly realized it would be difficult to support a family with just a high school diploma. So after a few years of struggling financially, he enrolled at the local community college. In his first semester, he worked full-time and took classes in the evening, but then it became apparent that this was going to be a long journey. So he quit his job and enrolled full-time. These were challenging years for the family. They rented a small home in an undesirable neighborhood. They stretched food as far as they possibly could, and they spent their Saturdays at the laundromat. And after 3 long years, the student graduated with an associate's degree in mechanical engineering. I'd like to tell you a story about a student who found out at the age of 17 that she was going to be a mother. Although not part of her plan, she married the father of her child and started a family. She was able to finish high school, but soon realized that she would only be able to qualify for minimum wage jobs. When her husband enrolled at the local community college, she picked up extra work so that she could try to make ends meet. When her husband finished his degree, she decided it was her turn to pursue her goals, so she enrolled at the local community college. The family did not want to return to the poverty that they had endured, so she decided it was in her family's best interest to work full-time and take classes in the evening. And after 5 long years, she graduated with an associate's degree in computer technology. I'd like to tell you a story about a student who grew up watching both of her parents enroll at the local community college. Now, she knew firsthand the challenges, the struggles, and the rewards of a college degree. But when it came time for her to make decisions about her future, she wasn't sure what she should do. She was working at Bojangles, and a manager talked with her about a management training program. She had friends who were going away to college, but she knew her parents could not afford to pay. I mean, they had just finished college themselves, and they were trying to get back on their feet. Not to mention, they were going through
a terrible divorce. So she decided that it was in her best interest to work full-time at Bojangles, enter into the management training program, and maybe one day, perhaps, enroll at the local community college. Right before graduation, a friend invited her to go on a college tour. She didn't want to go. I mean, what was the point? She had already made her plans. But her friend reminded her of something very important. This was an excused absence from school. And so she went. On the college tour, a financial aid representative talked with her about the FAFSA, where students could qualify for assistance for college. The financial aid representative also talked with her about student loans, where students could borrow money to help pay for college expenses. A faculty member asked her what she was interested in, encouraged her to apply, and told her she might qualify for a scholarship. And seemingly, out of nowhere, a new path was created, one that the student did not even consider was an option. After that college visit, she applied, she enrolled, started classes that fall. Now, you may be wondering, who are these students? But I have a feeling you've already guessed. It's me. It's my story, and it's the story of my parents. My story continues with going away to college only to feel very out of place. I felt like the other students knew how to do college. And so after my first week, I went to my advisor to discuss quitting. I really felt like I had made a big mistake, and I was really hoping my job at Bojangles was still there. My advisor encouraged me to give it a little more time. He said, hey, let's set up a weekly meeting. You can check in with me. Let's see how things are going. He also encouraged me to get involved, and so I did. And after my first club meeting, I instantly felt connected. The advisor for the club was also the director of counseling services, and he became my mentor. Although I had filled out the FAFSA, received some financial assistance, borrowed student loans, and received a scholarship, I was still struggling financially. So my advisor recommended I look into work study. So I did. I landed a job in the admissions office, and that became my second home. After changing my major 5 times, that's right, you heard me, 5 times, and stopping out of college on multiple occasions to work full-time, I became the first in my immediate family to graduate with a bachelor's degree. It took me 6 years, but I accomplished one of my biggest goals in life. And that is how my story started. Now, I'm guessing that there are many similar stories in this room. I am sure that some of you have faced greater challenges than I have, and maybe some of you less. Yet we find ourselves here today, together. Our paths have crossed, certainly no accident that our stories have intersected. You see, we all have a story to tell of how we got here today. But who I think is more important than the main character who gets all the attention are the supporting characters who play such an important role in determining the direction of our stories. I've tried to be very intentional about thanking the men and women who've helped me along the way in my story, from the financial aid representative who helped me with the FAFSA, to my advisor who never let me give up on myself, to my mentor who helped me through some very challenging times, to my faculty who inspired me, and to my work-study family who truly took me in as a member of their own personal family. You know, even though I've thanked them, I am not sure that they understand how different my story would be without them. The chapter after finishing my bachelor's degree included being the first in my extended family to earn a master's degree. It also included a lot of bumps in the roads and twists and turns before beginning the chapter that has now included over 20 years of working in higher education helping students write their stories. As I reflect upon my story and where I am today, I have to wonder if it's by accident that I've spent the last 14 years working at a community college helping students who are just like my mom and dad. I've had so many students share with me over the years about working full time and taking classes in the evening and struggling financially, spending their Saturdays and evenings at the kitchen table doing assignments while their children looked on. And these stories make me smile because I know firsthand that they are modeling the importance of education and the lasting impact that that will have on their children's stories. I had someone outside of Greenville Tech ask me recently, "Why do you care so much?" And to be honest with you, I didn't know how to respond. And the question really bothered me. And so I spent some time reflecting on my why. And the conclusion that I came to is that it is important for me to play a supporting character in student stories. I'm a faculty member who can inspire a student's next chapter. I'm a supporter of campus resources. I'm an advocate for campus engagement. I am a champion of work study. And I am an advisor who can change the direction of a student's story. Never in a million years did I think I would be working at a college. College was not even going to be part of my story. So it really goes to show that you never know where your story will take you. So what does the next chapter in your story look like? What will serve as your inspiration? I hope that your next chapter includes many stories of reaching out and lending a helping hand to those who need your assistance and thanking those who have helped you along the way. I hope that there will be multiple pages of you realizing that you have the power to change someone else's story. One of my favorite quotes is from Marianne Williamson, who says, "Our deepest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our deepest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure." Powerful beyond measure. I challenge you to use your power to transform someone else's story. And by doing so, you will create a chapter in your life that is everlasting.
This is for.
Okay, Amber finishes.
Amber just finished.
The applause.
Right.
John and Rachel return. Insert comments about our speakers today. Extra round of applause. Perhaps you too have an idea worth sharing or a story to tell. We hope you'll consider pursuing the opportunity to join us as a speaker at next year's event.
Yes, we know you'd like to meet our speakers. They'll be down here in the front. We know you'd like to come and encourage them. Whatever. And thank you again for joining Tech Talks 2023. Our thoughts, our stories, our people. All right, sit tight, everybody. We got some things to talk about. All right, everybody look at me. Where does this live? Right here.
Oh, I don't know.
Do not take it with you. Okay, don't put it in your pocket. The slide advancer always stays here. We're going to fix this mic situation. We can't.
We will have two mics.
We're
going
to have to get two.
Whatever it is, we will figure it out.
That made everybody a little, I know, more nervous to have to stand there, and it feels like the time is being wasted. So we're going to get that fixed. But remember, we'll get that worked out, and then the mic, the slide advancer stays here.
Yeah.
All right, do we want to come down?
Yeah, we'll come down.
Okay.
You guys, that's what today is for, is to get some of those jitters out. I know you practice and you think about that when you get up there in the moment, it's different. And when there's people in here tomorrow, it's going to be even different again.
It's going to feel very different.
Just take a big, deep breath and get it. You got through it today. If things didn't go exactly the way you thought they were going to go, that's okay. That's
what, almost kind of what you want to happen.
Yeah.
In a rehearsal like this.
Exactly.
So you don't want to peek at the rehearsal, you know? So that is why we do this. That's why we did the individual rehearsals. That's why we do a dress rehearsal. That's why we will have this space all morning tomorrow. We will be in here by 8:30 tomorrow morning. So we highly recommend you come as early as you can in your schedule if you want a run-through on the stage again with the clicker, et cetera. Definitely we will do that. So we made sure to reserve this space for nobody, not that anybody was going to use it, but we made sure to reserve it for the entire morning tomorrow. I think I would definitely encourage you to be here, we're saying 10:30, I'd say 10:15, so that we won't do a complete, you know, run through, but so that we can do a couple of times through the order and the swapping of mics. And again, we will have two. What two we will have, we don't know, so getting here by 10:15 will also allow you to be able to experience whichever mic you're going to have versus clicker. So we will get all of that figured out. All right, so.
But don't worry about technical things. Just let that all go through.
We're going to take care of that.
Don't go testing, testing, and you get out there. You just.
That's got your back.
That's got the control of that. So
that's why we put him up there, so he can mute and unmute.
Free your mind of any technical things at all. If you find the light of it bothering you a little bit,
but you don't have this bright of a light.
You do not. That's
okay.
And
we didn't have this spot when we did your individual rehearsals either. So.
New spot.
Yeah.
And it will be like that tomorrow.
So keep in mind when you wear glasses and that doesn't help.
Versus where that's coming.
Yeah, I was thinking it worked because it caught me and then it caught me and then I got stuck. The seats were good.
Again, that's why there's all these kinks that work out today. But no, this is the setup, what you see here. If we get the smooth transition with the mic, that won't be a distraction. Okay, and just remember we have volume, we'll all be controlled up there.
We will have bottled water. So if you need to bring water up with you and set it on the little table, you can do that.
And there's nothing wrong with if you get so caught in mouth and you think that's all you can concentrate on.
Oh, gosh.
It is okay.
I'm so sorry.
Yeah.
It
we'll
is
provide
okay
water and you can bring that
water
with you.
Any
or we'll just set some bottled water on the table so you can grab one if you need it.
Just hold the bottle of water.
Yeah. Set it back down.
But if you have to stop, and don't say excuse me, everybody's sorry, nothing. Just make it natural. Just stop, take a sip, put it down, and continue to talk. It's because that's acceptable to do that. That's not unprofessional. If you have to do it, it's better than getting so choked up that you can't talk and concentrate on anything else.
Mm-hmm.
And don't apologize for, sorry guys, I need to take some water.
Mm-hmm.
Don't put any of that stuff in there. Just take the water and continue.
That we have a couple other things, but I don't want to forget. So a couple things to help you prepare physically. Get a good night's rest tonight. Eat a good meal tomorrow morning. Lots of protein, because this takes a lot of energy out of you. So eat a good meal. Avoid caffeine. So I know those of you who need your coffee in the morning, maybe do your coffee, but try to trail it back a little bit. Warm, not hot. Hot coffee or hot tea, but warm tea, especially with some lemon and some honey is good. Avoid dairy products that will coat your throat and make you more likely to have that dry mouth. So a couple of things there. Again, we'll have bottled water for you. back, first of all, we heard several end with